In this video lecture, we'll go over a step-by-step procedure for turning some problem description into a black box model and then into some new Java method code. Okay, let's get started. So here's a general checklist for creating new Java methods. As you get some practice with this, it will all eventually become very second nature to you, I promise. First, you should always start with a problem description and a clear understanding of it. Next, turn that problem description into a black box model depiction by specifying a descriptive method name, all of the inputs or knowns, and the expected output. For the inputs and outputs, make sure that you also clearly specify their variable names and data types. Then, turn this black box model into a Java method interface and code skeleton, and be sure to add some pseudocode and some stubbed output so that your starting method can at least compile and run with any client code. We'll talk about pseudocode and stubbing in a moment. Once you have this skeleton of your method in place, finish it up by providing the method's implementation and be sure to precede the method with a short comment describing it. This is an expected coding standard for this course. If you're not already familiar with what it means, pseudocode is just the idea of sketching out the general flow of what your code will do without actually having to write it. You can think of it as the free format brainstorming or rough draft stab at your code. Have you ever seen it in a movie where some mad scientist or engineer or software developer is frantically scribbling out some idea all over a whiteboard? What they're doing is pseudocoding. You can rough out what your code is going to do using pseudocode comments, then gradually flesh out what your code needs to do using actual Java code. But do leave some of that pseudocoding in place as comments to document the logic flow of your actual code. In terms of stubbing your methods, this is just the idea of creating the interface shell for your method, and for now just returning some bogus starter value. There's a common principle in software development that you should nail down your interfaces first. Rather than worry about the details of how you're going to do something, just start by defining what you're going to do via setting up the interfaces of all your needed methods. Then, if your method is supposed to return some value, for now, just let it return some bogus value. The advantage of this approach is that it lets us set up the overall skeleton or framework of our code and come back to all the nagging details later. So for example, if your method is supposed to return some numerical value, just have it return 0 or some other recognizable value, such as minus 1 or 999. If your method returns a string, just have it return a TBD or an unknown for now, or hard-coded true or false if it's supposed to return a Boolean value. Are these the correct answers we're after? No, of course not. But this will be enough to get started and to keep the compiler happy, and it's enough so that this stub method can be called from some larger client code. It's enough to simply get started while the details are being fleshed out. Here's a good example of using that step-by-step process to set up a new Java method. Suppose we want a method to calculate the area of an isosceles trapezoid using this formula. Here's the geometric description of what we're trying to do. Given the two bases and the height of this figure, we want to know its area. So this is our problem description. Next, in step two, we'll turn our problem description into a black box model. Let's call our method calculate trapezoid area, since that pretty well describes what we're doing. It's a nice verb-based name, and it follows good camel case naming. Then our inputs are the three things we know, the two bases and the height. We'll just use the variable names from the diagram, and we'll specify the double data types for them, since we might need decimal point accuracy. Our one output, the unknown, is then the area, which we'll also declare as a double. In this third step, we'll use our prior information to set up the method interface. Using the method name, the input variables and their data types, and the data type of the output, which here is a double. Maybe we don't know yet how we'll implement this, so here we might put some pseudocode about our approach or the algorithm we think we'll use. But we won't sweat the details yet. Since we said that this method would return a double, here's a stubbed output value which matches the expected output type. At this point, this code will compile and could be called from some external client, even though it won't yet give the correct result, but it's enough to get started. Finally, here we replace the pseudocode with the actual method implementation, we replace the stubbed output with a correct output, and we add a short descriptive comment describing what our method does, per good coding practice and our course coding convention. If you need to, Please take a moment now to pause this video and view the short code walkthrough video for method example trapezoid.java, where we'll see how this method can be used. Open up this file in JGrasp so you can follow along. You'll find this example in the example source code module on Canvas.